I'd like to call the Roseville City Council meeting for March 25th, 2014 to order. At this time, I'd like to have the Boy Scout Pack 1412 of Huron Park come on up. They're going to lead us into the Pledge of Allegiance, and they have an introductory this evening. Gentlemen, the microphone's all yours.
Thank you, Mayor.
Is it on?
Do you have a colored light?
Let's see, which one is it?
Just push the button in until you see a colored light.
There you go. Thank you for having us here. We're Troop 1412 from Huron Park Elementary in Roseville. Our troop is proud of its long-standing heritage in Roseville. We're celebrating 89 years of service to our community. We're the oldest troop in our district. Some of our recent service projects include Color Guard leading this year's homecoming parade for Roseville High School. We performed a flag ceremony for Kaiser Elementary, presented a flag to the Kaiser family who donated the property that the school was built on at their anniversary party. We annually perform a spring cleanup for the VFW post on Gratiot Avenue. We also did a cleanup for St. Donald's Church last year. We've completed some large service projects through our Eagle Scout service project, which include building and installing handicapped picnic tables in Roseville Parks. We refurbished two gazebos at a local senior citizens community. We built a bench and provided a locking cabinet for a game room in a Roseville senior citizen housing community. We cleaned up and refurbished a playscape and play yard for a women's shelter in Roseville. One of our Eagle projects include repairing and painting a parish center at St. Basil's Church in East Point. Another project included cleaning up, painting, and landscaping a courtyard at St. Germain's in St. Clair Shores. We provided hundreds of personal hygiene kits for the homeless, and we volunteered at Alhambra's annual Life Handicap Fishing Derby. We also performed several landscaping projects at Holy Innocence Church, including rebuilding their baseball diamond. It gives us great pleasure performing these tasks for our community and also for performing this flag ceremony for you today. We'd also like to thank all of you for your service you provide to our community. We're also having a spaghetti dinner this Saturday at Holy Innocence Church. If you're all invited, and welcome to come. It goes from 3:30 to 7:30, and it's on Fraser Road in Roseville. I'm going to turn it over to our senior patrol leader, Nino Basile, who's going to do our color guard.
All rise. Color guard, attention. Color guard, forward march. Color guard, halt. Color guard, post the colors. All turn and face the American flag. Right hand over your heart. Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America. And into the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Two. Color guard, board dismissed.
I'd like to commend Boy Scout Cubs Pack 1412 for all they do in our community, and thank you, gentlemen, for doing the Pledge of Allegiance this evening with us. At this time, I would like the City Clerk to do the roll call.
Councilman Shoemaker?
Here.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Here.
Councilwoman Haw?
Here.
Councilwoman Haggerty?
Here.
Councilman Ayudo?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Taylor?
Here.
Mayor Turkin?
Here.
Show all members present this evening, Mayor.
Thank you. Are there any items the council wishes to have removed from the consent agenda and placed on the consent agenda action item? Mr. manager. I would like to pull out and talk about the issuance of resolutions, proclamations, and recognitions under the adoption of resolution revoking IFT certificates 2007-162, 2012-538, and 2012-540.
Mr. Mayor, we'll place those under new business item C.
Thank you. Can I have a motion now to approve the rest of the consent agenda item without the resolutions as stated previously?
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor, supported by Councilwoman McCartney. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Under consent agenda action items, Mr. Atkins, can you explain to us and the public why I asked to have that pulled out?
Yes, Mayor, members of council. The items that you have, the industrial facilities tax certificates 2007-162, 2012-538, and 2012-540. All of these certificates actually belong to one facility located on Grosbeck. The facility is Paul Marino Gage Incorporated American Modular Tool. This business, as some of you may recall, relocated to Roseville from the city of Warren. That IFT certificate 2007-162 is actually a transfer certificate from the city of Warren that was approved to be transferred to Roseville. The other two certificates were certificates approved by the city council, one for real property and one for personal property. As you recall, as a process under Act 198 for the industrial facilities tax exemption, a applicant is required to fill out a formal application as provided by the state tax commission. In doing so, they state that they're going to create a certain number of jobs for job creation, make a certain dollar amount of investment in real and personal property, and they attest to this as part of that certification process. In this case, the business has failed to do so in accordance with their application that was submitted to the city and approved by the city council. In addition, they have been in previous default on taxes to the city of Warren, and they are currently delinquent on their taxes to the city of Roseville. In addition, we understand that they have filed a claim of bankruptcy, and Attorney Tomlinson is filing our claim into that appeal. City Treasurer Swatalski has also filed what's known as a jeopardy tax assessment to secure the city's interest on the current taxes. So in the best interest of the city, we're asking for your consideration on approving resolutions, asking the State Tax Commission to consider revocation of all three of these IFTs, again, based on the failure of compliance on the original application. And I hope that answers some questions in a quick time.
Are there any other questions for Mr. Atkins regarding this? Mayor Pro Tem.
Mr. Atkins, do you know off the top of your head what the total monetary value it is that they're in default of?
I do not have the total dollar amount here this evening. I believe that the one tax bill to us is in the realm of around $29,000 or $30,000. Again, we want to make sure that we catch this prior to that accruing additional amounts.
And we're able to put a lien on their property and their equipment in order to possibly regain our losses here?
Well, we were able to invoke a jeopardy tax assessment going in and putting an assessment in prior to the formal tax date. With the bankruptcy piece, it does get a little more complicated. So we're at this point reviewing, again, there's a time frame, and Mr. Dolan could probably go in a little further. Depending on when that claim was filed on the bankruptcy is dependent on what we may be able to do. However, we are getting ourselves positioned to be able to be a claimant in that bankruptcy process, which would include any delinquent taxes, utility bills, or any other fees to the city.
Okay, thanks. That's all I have, Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Atkins, if we approve or deny this, and say we do approve it, and it goes to the state of Michigan, what happens then? Or if you or Mr. Dolan?
I'll take part, and Mr. Dolan can jump in. The State Tax Commission will have the ultimate decision on the revocation of the request from the city. They generally do look at all of these with a fine-tooth comb based upon the filings. I believe that we have a very strong case with the delinquencies and failure to comply in the original application. Mr. Dolan?
That's correct. The actual body that makes the determination as to revocation is the State Tax Commission. They'll conduct a hearing. They'll review the evidence that's before them. They'll give the petitioner an opportunity to participate and speak, but it appears from the evidence that's being discussed tonight, that there aren't any serious questions of fact. They're in default on the taxes owed in Warren. They're in default on the taxes owed in Roseville, and they have not achieved the representations that they made at the time of their application.
Okay. Are there any further questions? City Councilwoman McCartney.
What is the time frame on this? Do we have a, I mean, is it months, years?
I don't have
normally.
The
yeah, exactly.
Basically, they'll take action probably within the next 90 days.
In a normal set of circumstances, an applicant has 2 years from the time that their certificate is granted to meet compliance. However, because of the extraordinary circumstances here, obviously we're requesting the State Tax Commission to consider revocation prior to that 2-year period of time. I mean, they certainly are in default of the taxes at this point, so it's very unlikely that they'll be able to position themselves to achieve the job creation and the investment.
Is there ever a time where a city would not be granted this because of him filing bankruptcy?
Well, he might, for example, there could be situations where they could enter into a Chapter 11 where there's a consent agreement worked out where they have time to more or less correct their default. Under those types of settings, if they're otherwise compliant, the tax tribunal would probably not revoke their IFT, but they have to be in a position to demonstrate good faith. And I concur with the stance taken by the administration here. There are just too many factors that mitigate against them being in a position of demonstrating good faith. They're in default in two communities, and they haven't achieved they really haven't come close to achieving these goals as far as I know.
That's all I have, Mayor. Thank you.
Councilwoman Hagan.
Mr. Atkins, are they delinquent in 1 year, 2 years, how many?
They are currently delinquent. They'll be going into their second term of delinquency here. They started in 2013, and now they're going into the 2014 season. We don't see any difference here. The taxes, I believe, in Warren were previous year taxes. I believe those are 2012 taxes. Just the fact that they haven't paid their taxes, which are a requirement generally in the granting of the IFT, they're technically in default of this, according to the agreement, which is also spelled out in our IFT policy. As some of you may recall, we have a very detailed policy that we share with the applicants prior to even having the public hearing for consideration that states what the goals and objectives of Act 198 are, as well as what our expectations. And they do attest by signing their application that they're going to fulfill those. Payment of taxes is one of those pieces.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Seeing none, the motion is in order.
Mr. Mayor, do we need a motion on all three of them, or can we do it on just one?
We can do it on one.
But this is agenda item, new business C.
Yeah.
Excuse me, Mayor. I moved it to an action item under new business C. If you'd like to take your vote at that time, that may be easier for council. And one motion for all three resolutions would
okay.
Be fine.
All right. Assuming that, our next item is presentation to award to the winners of the Project Art in Roseville Art Expo 2014. Could I have Ms. Charlotte Boyd and the other members of PAIR to please come up and join us at the podium? And could I have the City Council come down, please?
The citizens of Roseville and the youth of Roseville are very lucky to have a city council and a board of education that recognizes the value of art in our youth in the city. And they did this year by declaring official January Youth Art Month. So every year from now on, we'll be able to say Roseville is celebrating Youth Art Month. So remember, your children are also invited to celebrate that time. At this time, we'd like to be able to present the certificates of the winners of our Project Art in Roseville, the fifth annual paper art expo. What we ask the artists to do, from kindergarten to eighth grade, is take one piece of 8.5 inch by 11 inch white paper, just like your copy paper for your computer, and turn it into a piece of art. And this year we have 1,000 entries. They're on display at the Macomb Mall and will be so until April 30th. On Saturdays and Sundays from 2 to 6, your artists can come in and be able to come into the exhibit and take a picture with their artwork. So we'd like to see them there. At this time, I'd like to present our committee, our president, Beverly Mason, member Christine Palin, Ted Lassiter, our treasurer, Charlie Mason, sorry, member, and our vice president, Terry Bosnick. So, for category one, we have our young man available. With Mr. Martin Norgren, come up and receive your certificate. For category two, first place, Sierra Bragg.
Sierra's not here.
Rosalind Johnson Carter, coming in. She's not here. Do we have Deha Branch?
No, Deha's
not here. Category three, do we have Zoe Carter? Zoe? We have her listed as being here today, but I guess she didn't. Okay. And Ariana Anderson?
There we go.
Then know you were going to be so popular. Brennan Cole, first place category four. And we have Victoria McCaskill. And Kadiah Favors. Oh, okay. Is he here?
I don't see her.
He's not here?
She was supposed to be here.
She was, oh. Well, thank you very much, and I hope that you all remember that you too can be a part of our committee. We are members of the community. The City Council has graciously put together the committee, agreed to sponsor PAIR, which is Project Out in Roseville. And we need committee members always, as everyone always does. And if you'd like to be a member, call City Council and the manager's office will put you in contact with us. So, thank you, gentlemen and ladies, for participating in our paper expo. And congratulations to all of you.
Thank you.
I'd like to commend all the members of the Project Art in Roseville, and I'd like to commend and thank all the young participants that took the time out of their schedule to do the artwork. And it's something to be seen. If you go over to the McComb Mall, they'll showcase it. It'll be there for the rest of the week, or month, I should say. So if you get a chance, stop by and see it. At this time is a public hearing. The hearing of the public will be on agenda items only. Upon approaching the podium, please state your name and address. Address the chair. You're welcome to direct questions, input information, and express opinions to council. Anyone using inappropriate language will be called out of order and correct their language or leave the podium. Please limit your remarks to 3 minutes. Is there anybody from the public wish to be heard on agenda items only this evening? Yes, sir.
Yes, Mayor. Council, Joseph D. Police. 15437 Curtis, Roseville. I just witnessed this fine event here with the youth, and I'm glad the city and everybody got this. Anything to do with youth, it's great. And I just want to give everybody a big hand on that.
All right. Thank you, John. Thank you. For those who don't know it, Mr. Felice is on the Roseville School Board. He's a trustee, and we'd like to thank their participation in this also. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard on agenda items only? Anybody else wish to be heard? Seeing none, we will move into new business. Request awarding a bid of mowing and maintenance services. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council. Specifications were written for the mowing and maintenance services contract. Bid invitations were posted on the Michigan Intergovernmental Trade Network, that's the MITN website, as well as the city website and the McComb Daily. Six companies responded to the proposal solicitation. The bids were reviewed, and the three lowest companies were interviewed by Mr. Tom Iudo, DPS Director, Robert Cady, Assistant City Manager and Controller, and Paul Van Dam, Purchasing Assistant. The lowest bidder that met the specifications for mowing in the city's municipal properties and parks and the amount of $61,683 and the broadleaf weed control for Gratiot Avenue and the amount of $1,593 is Green Meadows Lawnscape of Shelby Township. This is a total of $63,278 per year. Green Meadows has performed for the City of Troy, City of Sterling Heights, and several private companies in a satisfactory manner and have been recommended from their references. The lowest bidder meeting the specifications for the spring and fall cleanups, which includes all municipal properties and parks, in the amount of $1,325 each, right-of-ways in the amount of $10,500, and the Aaron Grove Cemetery in the amount of $1,125 is JR Services Group, LLC of Troy. Total amount, $14,275 per year. JR Services Group has performed business in a satisfactory manner for the city as well as surrounding communities. Therefore, the committee has reviewed and it has been recommended that the council consider accepting the bids submitted for the municipal mowing of the municipal buildings and parks and broadleaf weed control for Gratiot in the amount of $63,276 to Green Meadows Landscape, and also recommended to accept the bid submitted for spring and fall cleanups, right-of-way mowing, and Aaron Grove Cemetery in the amount of $14,275 to JR Services Group. Again, these items have been bid in a multi-year format. However, there is language that is contained within the proposed contracts that would allow for a severing of the contract after the first year. Again, we have discussed, or at least I've discussed with council before, that this is an item still subject for upcoming negotiations with the AFSCME Unit 520. However, in light of the timing of that process, which has not yet started, this is necessary for this year's mowing services. It is also a substantial saving as compared to the previous year. I am not sure. Yes, Mr. Van Dam is here. Also, Mr. Cady is here to answer any specific questions. But again, that is the recommendation for the council to consider approval on the bid contracts. It was also decided in the best interest of the city financially to divide these two, to divide the bids across two vendors, again, for performance and financial matters for the city. And it is substantially less than previous year's service. Be glad to answer any questions.
Councilwoman McCurtain.
On JR Services, the $10,500 right-of-ways, what does that include? Is that cleanup, mowing? What is that?
That's the mowing portion for the right-of-ways, and these are public right-of-way areas that we are responsible for mowing. So within certain drainage areas, not the certain drainage areas, certain road right-of-way pieces.
And that'd be a weekly basis then, or? Is that weekly?
Those are generally set up starting on a weekly basis, but we do cater those to the mowing needs. As we got longer in the season this past year, the mowing started to get out spread out. So obviously we do more mowing at the beginning of the season than we do at the end.
Okay, that's all I have, Mayor.
Councilwoman Hager.
And JR Services is willing to accept just these portions of the bid since we're not giving them the whole thing?
Yes, we did have within the bid requirements the ability to accept or reject any portion or the entire bids. There were meetings with each of the vendors and they're aware of the division of the proposal.
Okay, thank you.
Councilwoman Huff.
Is this a different person than we had last year?
Yes, it is.
Okay, thank you.
Councilman Ayudo.
You had made a comment that after the first year we can change the vendor. We have a performance clause in the contract as well, do we not, that if after the first 10 weeks we're not happy, we can terminate for cause?
There's always a performance clause and a severability clause in each of the contracts. Mr. Tomlinson is generally involved in reviewing those and structuring those contracts. We do have performance pieces as well.
And there is such a degree of difference between some of these vendors, like last year's vendor and this year's vendor. Obviously, you stated that you checked the references and the professionals within our city have authorized Green Meadows and JR Services?
That is correct.
Any idea why there's such almost twice as much?
I'm not sure why the spread was as far as it was. I mean, obviously, I think there is a difference between each company on where they have their other book of work. For instance, if Green Meadows has work that they're also performing in Clinton Township or in a nearby community, they're generally able to adjust their prices based upon their staffing. That's what we found in the past. I just want to note that last year it was a different situation. We did not have the large number of interests here in the city to do this. And also, we did not do a split bid or a split bid consideration last year. But Mr. Van Dam may be able to provide some additional input, or Mr. Cady, but I would speculate that the difference in the spread in this is based upon their workloads and where their crews are deployed. That usually has been the case.
And this is based on our new rules that the height of the grass is shorter than it was last year, so cutting may happen more frequently. They still have to take a picture of the before and after when they cut, correct?
Well, this piece isn't dealing necessarily with the code piece. This is dealing with our general property mowings. However, we do expect our vendors doing this to follow the same ordinances. Obviously, the city has to set an example and make sure that we're following our own ordinance before we expect others to do the same.
Thank you. That's all I have.
Any other questions? Mayor Pro Tem.
Mr. Atkins, you said it was a savings. Do we have an idea what the savings is from last year?
I believe, and I'll get something thrown over, $80,000.
Mr. Van Dam, here, take a...
You said there's $80,000?
Mr. Van Dam will verify the dollar amount. It's significant.
Yeah, come on up to the podium and let everybody know who you are.
Paul Van Dam, purchasing assistant, 29777 Gratiot Avenue. Last year, we bid with Landscape Services, and that was for $130,000.
So that's a pretty considerable savings, and that's...
So we're almost saving 50% then.
And on top of that, that was only for the mowing of the parks and for the medium of Gratiot. So with this contract, or bid, if you approve it in whole, it'll be the parks, municipal buildings, Gratiot, the 41 right-of-ways, the fall and spring cleanups, and the cemetery, which the city acquired to maintain through the state.
Will this also the 13-mile drain?
No, the 13-mile drain is connected to the nuisance weed cuttings, and that is through GR Services, okay. But through the last bid that we granted last
year. Councilman McCartney.
Real quick, would the cleanup include the when you get off of 696 at the Gratiot area? Because that's seemed to be...
The fall spring cleanups is just for the general buildings, leaves, debris, things of that sort. Now, in the contract itself is for the pickup of litter every time that they mow going forward. The right-of-ways and cemetery will be done bi-weekly. The municipal buildings, parks, and Gratiot will be done weekly. It's based on 30 cuts, mows for the season for the main mowing project, 15 cuts for the right-of-ways and the supplemental.
Does that, when you say right-of-way, will that include that area? The
yes.
11 mile?
That's considered a right-of-way.
Okay. That's all I have.
Mayor Pro Tem.
Mr. Van Dam, will you be working with Mr. Ayuto on with this company? Is that what I'm understanding here, or you just were you involved in the bid process? I guess I'm making a request. You know, last year I know a lot of citizens came to me. I don't know. I would assume the rest of the council, but it just seemed like Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday when you have visitors coming in from maybe, you know, different parts of the United States, for that matter, just here to visit. And it just looked like the Gratiot corridor wasn't kept up. I mean, they might have cut the grass on Monday, but on Friday and Saturday and the weekends when everybody was here, it really didn't look all that well. And I was just wanting maybe a suggestion to the company that we really want to spruce it up because we're trying to bring businesses here, we're trying to bring families here, and we really want to impress everybody, and I think that's a good way to start.
And I completely agree with you. This company promised us that they would have enough mowers and crews available where they could basically cut Thursday and Friday within the city for exactly what you stated will happen. The parks need to be cut on Thursday because most of the games and activities happen in the parks during the weekend. So they promised that they could probably go through this whole city within 2 days and have that done. And to address Mr. Ayuto's comment, there are two different heights that the grass will be cut. There needs to be different lengths for the parks, the ball fields, and the soccer fields. And then there's just a little higher than for the rest of the municipal buildings and right away.
That's all I have, Mr. Mayor. Thanks. Okay.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you, Mr. Van Dam. At this time, can I have a motion then, please?
Stuart,
go ahead.
Go ahead.
Mr. Mayor, I'll make the motion to approve the request as presented to Green Meadows Landscaping and GNR Services Group.
Support.
Yeah, you got a motion by Mayor Pro Tem, supported by Councilwoman Haggerty. Any other discussion? Mr. Atkins, I'd like to thank you and your committee that did this. You saved us a lot of money, and that's what's good for when things go out to bid.
Absolutely.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is public hearing on proposed statement of community development objectives and projected use of funds 2014-2015. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council. At the March 11th regular meeting under the manager's report, I reported on the objectives for the community development block grant use proposed for 2014-2015. This evening, Mr. Connors is here to answer questions for the council and also give a brief summary of the CDBG objectives and proposed use of funds. Advertisement was placed in the March 12th, 2014 East Sider based on the projected budget. The amounts presented to you at the meeting are the allocated amounts, and you do have additional information that has been presented to you this evening, as well as will be shared by Mr. Connors. This will be set for final adoption at the regular meeting on April 8th.
Mr. Connors, floor is yours.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Just like to walk you through the presentation here, a brief presentation on the our city's U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development Community Development Block Grant Program. As Mr. Atkins has stated, we did receive from HUD our actual allocation. Our 14-15 allocation is $526,106. And the ad that was in the paper was a projected amount. So just to walk you through the process, we launched the formal CDBG application December 20th of 13, and those applications were due the end of January. We met with our citizens advisor.
Can you see if that microphone's turned down?
Yeah, we can hear it.
Can you hear him in the back?
The light's on, but no one's home.
Talk close.
We hear your tap.
Talk close.
We hear your tapping. Oh,
thank you.
Okay. So the grant cycle process, can you hear me now?
Mm-hmm.
We launched the CDBG applications in December 2013. The applications were due January 28th of 2014. Here in Roseville, we met with our Citizens Advisory Committee on December 4th and the 12th to discuss the CDBG budgetary items in connection with general community projects. We'll have two public hearings on this. The first one is tonight, and the second one is on April 8th. We also have going on, the city is, as a requirement to be a CDBG HUD entitlement community, we're required to do a five-year consolidated plan. So we're in the process of updating our consolidated plan with Macomb County Home Consortium, in addition to Sterling Heights and the township. We're in that process. That'll be back before you middle of April. We'll have a separate presentation on that. That five-year plan sets the goals and priorities of moving the CDBG program forward. So every year that we apply to HUD, it's an action plan against the five-year plan. So this is the proposed budget for 2014-15. We have a grant allocation. We're anticipating $56,000 of program income, which is received from our revolving loan funds for our housing rehabilitation program. That will be reprogrammed back into the local road projects. We're looking to do the bulk of the projects is for local streets. We're going to do one complete reconstruction of Mackinac Street from 10 Mile North to Church. It's in Census Tract 2565. It's in an eligible area for the program. We're looking to fund $65,000 the code enforcement, rodent control. We want to maintain the integrity of the housing stock. We have the administration, which assists with not only community development block grant, but economic development and other initiatives that we undertake. We did receive a request for a piece of our admin from the Home Homeless Coalition to fund a continuum of care coordinator. And then we get down to the public service agencies. We received four applications. One was $27,000 for the senior chore services, the Macomb County Community Services Agency. They do grass cutting, snow removal for seniors and the disabled here in the city. St. Vincent de Paul, $10,000 was their application. They do emergency assistance, help with utilities and things of that nature. The Hope Center, actually a Fraser proposing a $20,000 to finance their operation. They're a true one-stop shop of hosting numerous other nonprofits to benefit our residents. And then we have Macomb County Rotating Emergency Shelter Team, a request for $6,500 in total. And McCrest does the homeless shelter through five local area churches here in the city of Roseville. And this is our allocation. This is the specifically the Mackinac Street 10 mile to church. This is in an eligible area as determined by census. And Mackinac is the street right here, which is 10 mile north to church. I do have a few photos to share of the existing conditions that are out there. This is asphalt. We will be replacing that with concrete. It'll be a complete reconstruct of the residential street. So it's seen better days. Look, as funds become more scarce, these federal funds look to be more enticed, and they plug gaps of repairing our roads in our residential areas. This is just a matrix, if you will, of the actual applications received based upon their funding request, how many persons they anticipate serving, and in addition to the leveraged funds. And that is also in your packet. So with that, I'll yield to any questions you have on the program.
Any questions for Mr. Conner this evening? Councilman Shoemaker.
Yeah, Mr. Conner, there's four applications for grants for public service. There was no additional applications?
Those were all the applications that we received.
That was it. Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Conner, how much difference is this from last year to this year that we received less funds? Am I correct?
We received slightly more funds.
Oh, more funds this year?
Yeah, we had budgeted a 4.5% increase, and we got about 4% increase. So,
okay.
Very slight, but we'll take it right now.
Okay. The Lighthouse did not put an application in?
Correct.
Okay. Any other questions? Councilwoman Hall.
So everybody that did submit an application did get part of the funding?
Yes. Everyone who applied is right before you.
Okay.
And there's enough money to cover everything without any controversy or you know.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anybody from the public wish to be heard on the community block grant issue? Anybody from the public wish to be heard? Come on up. Please give your name and address for the record. Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Margaret Love. I work for Macomb County, 21885 Dunham Road, Clinton Township, 28036. I'm the Senior Services Coordinator for the Tour Services Program for Macomb County. Now, you don't have to raise your hand. How many of you have had a grandparent, mother or father, sibling, or someone close to you with Alzheimer's disease or dementia? What about Parkinson's disease? Kidney disease, arthritis, COPD or congestive heart failure, lung cancer, other sorts of cancer, diabetes. I bet most of you would have had your hand raised. All of these conditions disproportionately affect people 60 and older. Now imagine your loved one dealing with the pain and dignity and loss of independence that accompany many of these diseases while living on $1,500 a month. Or $750 a month. These are the people the Tour Services Program helps. We keep low to moderate income seniors in their homes, living in dignity and independence. We do this by providing the basic physical chores that most homeowners take for granted. Services like lawn cutting and edging, snow removal, gutter cleaning, yard cleanup. Yeah, I know we don't take snow removal for granted these days, but minor home repairs and odd jobs such as window screen or air conditioner replacement, minor electrical and plumbing jobs, or door or lock repair. We also help the community as a whole. We keep the blight at bay. We prevent vacant homes, and we help preserve existing single-family neighborhoods. As you can see from the proposed budget that Mr. Connors presented, we have asked for $27,000 for fiscal year 2014-15. To put things in perspective, so far this year, we have served 91 clients in the city of Roseville. We've provided 1,177 units of service to those individuals, most of which has been in snow removal thus far. If we charge the full amount of the cost of that service, or $22.20 per unit, the city of Roseville would have been billed $26,135 just for the past 6 months. At a discounted rate, we are able to charge at $13.50 per unit. Keeping those people in their homes safe has cost $15,893, or a little over 70% of your total allocated amount for 13-14. Think about what you would pay for your own lawn service or snow removal. You can't even pay the kid next door to mow your lawn or shovel your walk for $13.50. So taking a step back and looking at the national objectives of CDBG funding, we benefit low and moderate income homeowners, we aid in the prevention or elimination of slums and blight, and we address the priorities of housing, homelessness, and community development needs, and we're a bargain in the process. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you, Ms. Love, for coming out here. I don't think we've ever had anybody from Macomb County come and give us a presentation like this, so thank you very much.
My pleasure. Okay.
This is still a public hearing. Does anybody else want to be heard by the City Council in regards?
I'm Pat Rice, 16244 Wilmington. I am the treasurer of the Conference for the Sacred Heart, San Francisco Fall. And we do appreciate the funding that we can help the homeless and people in need.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Verancia Daffin, and I am the Continuum of Care Coordinator for the Macomb Homeless Coalition. And we're located at 33222 Grosbeck, actually in the Hope Center, one of the programs that he mentioned earlier. I do have some brochures, if you guys would like to.
Sure.
These are some of the services that are provided by some of our 40 organizations that we are the coordinating, overseeing body for. The Macomb Homeless Coalition serves as the coordinating body for our county's continuum of care, with a membership of over 40 organizations providing direct services to our homeless and those in need. The Community Development Block Grant funding in the Public Service Administration area would further our coordination and planning activities for the total community, continuum of care body. The activities include submitting the HUD grant for the continuum of care and the subgrantees for the Supportive Housing Program grant that provides federal funding for agencies in our county to provide the direct services, shelter, emergency shelters, transitional housing, and permanent supportive housing for homeless citizens. This HUD process, the grant has to have continued monitoring as well as grant management. In 2013, through these efforts, we were able to bring in over $1.3 million for these organizations to provide their services to help those in need. Additionally, in 2013, through these coordination efforts, we were awarded over $600,000 by MISHTA in the Emergency Solutions grant area that provided rapid rehousing as well as homeless prevention services, which in our actuality we were able to place many citizens in permanent housing where they received the case management needed to become stabilized and remain housed. The coordination and planning service activities also include conducting our community connection days, which we do that 3 times a year, and it's sort of a one-stop shop event providing services, and that's direct services on that day, and identifying resources for homeless and those are low income. The event is publicized as well as it allows the other human service agencies to showcase the services that they provide for our citizens in need, as well as host workshops that provide the elimination of barriers for homelessness. So at this, at the Community Connection Day, the citizens are also educated to move on to self-sufficiency. These services also allow us to continue establishing, updating, and implementing the 10-year plan, which is a mandate also from our federal funding. Our HMIS, Homeless Management Information System, we are the lead agency, and we provide technical assistance and training to the participating agencies so that they can report the progress, the data, and the statistics needed for many federal grants. Lastly, we also do, well, actually we do a few more. I just gave you just a short list, but the last thing I'm going to touch on today is our point in time count, which is a very important activity that is coordinated by the services provided through this, through the funding. The point in time count is a federal mandate that allows us to identify those homeless individuals that are homeless on a single day, sheltered as well as unsheltered. So we train volunteers, we go out in the community. This year was between 12 a.m. and 4 a.m. and to some of the areas where there are known and some unknown places where some of our homeless citizens seek shelter or some things out of the just to get out of the weather. We didn't find as many as we did in years previous, and that was a good thing because it was one of the coldest days of the year, and of course they were all seeking shelter, and so we were able to count them in shelter. But some of the, we were glad not to find some of the unsheltered this year. And now we have Denise, who is our system administrator, and she's going to just give you a few more statistics. Specifically, she does our numbers on some things that are happening in the county and directly reflecting Roseville.
I have exceeded the 3 minutes.
Hello, everyone. My name is Denise Gosch, and I'm the director of Macomb Homeless Coalition, as well as the HMIS system administrator. If you guys do not know what HMIS stands for, it's Homeless Management Information System, and this is from HUD. Okay, so in Roseville, from last year of March 2013 till this year, February 28th, 2014, I ran a report that comes from ARC that shows that we have serviced 329 persons in Roseville alone. This includes 28 chronically homeless persons as well as 47 families within Roseville. So I want to open up for any questions that you may have about HMIS or
Macomb. Does the council have any questions from? I guess not. But thank you very much for the useful information, and we appreciate your time this evening.
And thank you so much for awarding us the grant.
Thank you.
And it was a beautiful private art that you guys put on.
Well, thank you very much. Does anybody else in the public wish to be heard? Yes, ma'am.
Good evening. I'm Lisa Chambers, and I am the administrative assistant at Hope Center. Just wanted to give you guys a real quick overview. If you're not familiar with Hope Center, we are the largest client, no-cost client food pantry in Macomb County. Last year, we serviced 48,000 individuals from Macomb County, 4,700 of which were from the city of Roseville. We distributed 1.9 million pounds of food last year. Not only are we a food pantry, but we are also a one-stop shop. We have all sorts of agencies right within Hope Center that we house, so that when people come, their first need is food. That's the emergency service that we provide for them. But while they're there, our volunteers interview them, ask what other needs that they may have, so that we can service them right within Hope Center, so that anybody with transportation issues doesn't have to worry about it. They can come to one place and get all their issues taken care of, usually in one visit. That includes utilities, housing, counseling services, and so forth. So we have Good Shepherd Coalition, Macomb Homeless Coalition, Veteran Services comes, we have Legal Aid that comes once a month. We house all of these agencies there. So that's what Hope Center is.
Okay, thank you.
Any questions?
Is there any questions from?
Thank you.
The only thing is, to the clerk, do you have any information at the Hope Center in your office, so if people come in and ask for it, you can give it to them?
Mayor, I do not, but I'd be more than happy to have that information available.
There you go.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Anybody else from the public wish to be heard on agenda items only? Anybody else on agenda items only? Okay, seeing none, we will move to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman Hagerty, supported by Councilwoman McCartney, to close the public hearing. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next is a motion to...
He had a hand up.
I'm sorry.
In the audience. Gentleman had his hand up.
I have a public comment. I just thought about this.
Well, we've already done this, so you'll have to wait till the end of the meeting then.
All right.
Okay. Any other things, Mr.? This is just a public hearing, correct? There's no action taken?
That is correct. The action will be at the April 8th meeting on this item.
All right. Next item is C, the agenda item that was pulled off for the issuance of resolution, proclamation, and recognitions of the request approval to adopt resolution revoking IFT certificate 2007-162, 2012-538, and 2012-540. Do you have anything to add, Mr. Atkins?
Mayor, I do not at this time.
Okay. Are there any questions still from Mr. Atkins regarding this agenda item? Okay, seeing none, can I have a motion then, please?
Mayor, I'll make the motion to approve the adoption of the resolution revoking IFT. Can I state all three at once? Number 2007-162, number 2012-538, and certificate number 2012-540.
Support.
Okay, so I have a motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. Mr. Clerk, I understand that the state requires a roll call vote, so can you conduct one, please?
Yes. Councilman Ayudo?
I had one other question before we vote, and that Mr. Atkins, did the original petitioner get notified that we were going to be voting on revoking his certificate?
I'm not aware if the notification was sent out. It did not, in talking with Mr. Tomlinson, it did not require a notification or a posting on this. I know Mr. Tomlinson did handle the bulk and majority of this piece, but I'm not aware if a specific notification was sent. I do know that the petitioner was aware of the default on the taxes and was aware of the jeopardy tax assessment piece. I would assume that the treasurer also mentioned the discussion of the IFT portion.
Okay. Thank you.
All right.
Yes.
Councilman Ayudo?
Yes.
Councilwoman Hagerty?
Yes.
Councilwoman Ha?
Yes.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Yes.
Councilman Shoemaker?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Taylor?
Yes.
Mayor Turkin?
Yes.
7 positive votes, Mayor motion carried.
All right, thank you. Next item is appointments. I have none this evening. So reports from administration and departments. First, City Clerk, Mr. Steenman.
Yes, Mayor, I was asked to provide a little information from the Roseville Fire Department to advise the public on the upcoming event at the, well, they changed it, Great Lakes Sports City in Fraser. Basically indicating the Roseville Fire Department and the Fraser Public Safety Department will be competing in their annual Fire versus Police Grudge Match hockey game. All proceeds from the game and t-shirt sales, which I do have available in the City Clerk's office for $15, Mayor and Council, I'm sure you'll be happy to grab one this evening. I made sure I had sizes for all of you. All proceeds from the game and the t-shirt sales will go to Camp Quality of Michigan. Camp Quality is a week-long camp during the summer that gives kids with cancer a chance to be children again. Again, it's a great benefit, and the hockey game will be held at Green Lake Sports City at 34400 Utica Road in Fraser. The game will be Sunday, March the 30th, 2014 at 1 p.m. Tickets are $10. So anybody that does is interested in donating to a great cause, for $15 you can get a t-shirt at the fire department or the city clerk's office at your convenience.
And if the Roseville Fire Dogs win, the trophy will come home, correct?
The trophy will come home. We have a place to display it, ready and waiting.
Okay. Are there any questions for the clerk this evening? Seeing none, we'll move into reports of the city manager, Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, unlike the esteemed clerk, I have no t-shirts to offer or exciting events dealing with hockey. However, what is exciting is we're hoping that spring will be here soon. Compost collection is scheduled to begin on March 31st. Let us all cross our fingers. We never thought we'd be so looking forward to compost recycling. The Police Honor Guard fundraiser that was scheduled and advertised in the city calendar for April of 2014 has been canceled. Any updates regarding a future reschedule will be posted on the city website. Green Tech Electronic Recycling will be collecting electronic recyclable items on Saturday, April 26th from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. at the City Hall parking lot. For more information, you can visit www.greentechrecyclers.com. We'll also place a link on the city website. Council members were given some information this evening and invited to participate in the Michigan No Kill Conference dealing with animal issues. That conference will be Thursday and Friday, September 4th and 5th. We can register you here at the office if you are interested, and you do have a copy of a flyer that was placed before you this evening. Reminder that the budget meeting, which is a pre-budget meeting, will be this Saturday, March 29th, 10 a.m. here at the City Hall Manager's Conference office. It'll start the process off in earnest. And then also I wanted the council to be aware that I did receive an email from a representative from Dominion Technologies on Sturgeon Road concerning the condition of the road, and I'm sure you've all been contacted in the past. We realize that the road is in terrible condition, but obviously with funding being limited on our major streets, there are not ample funds at this time to go forward with any major reconstruction project. I have spoken with several other businesses. We have encouraged them if they'd like to start the special assessment process that we would look at that, and also we'll have further discussion with the council about any possibilities for funding in the future, but I wanted you to be aware that we have received correspondence, and I will be responding back that we have no additional funding available for the road construction at this time, but we'll consider to discuss this, and also the special assessment process is always available if the property owners are willing to undertake that. I'd be glad to answer any questions that council may have.
Are there any questions for Mr. Atkins? Mr. Atkins, I know the street in question that you were talking about quite a few years back, we had placed it on the agenda to do a special assessment, and all the property owners at that time did not want that road repaired. So I think they changed their tune after this many years have passed by. So if they want to do it, we'll bring it up before a study session. Then. Any other questions? Seeing none, reports of city attorney, Mr. Dolan. It's good to see you this evening.
It's very nice to be here this evening. Mayor and members of council, I don't have any specific items to report on this evening.
Are there any legal questions for Mr. Dolan this evening? Seeing that, we will move into the second hearing of the public. The second hearing of the public will be for any city business. Upon approaching the podium, please state your name and address. Address the chair. We welcome direct questions, input information, and express opinions to council. Anyone using inappropriate language, be called out of order, correct their language, leave the podium. Limit your remarks not to exceed 3 minutes. Anyone not adhering to these rules will be called out of order by the chair. Anybody from the public wish to be heard by the city council this evening? Sir, you had your hand up earlier. Please give your name and address for the record.
My name is Gerald Burak. My address is 28673 Sunray Court. I'd like to know why, if you get a copy of my driving record from Secretary of State, which I have here, the accident that occurred at Jacob Sidway crashed into me right in front of Roseville City Hall on October 21st, 2009, it's not on my record. And when I called Secretary of State to investigate this for my appeal, they said to check with them before your appeal to see if they reported this accident to Secretary of State. Since 2014, you've never reported this accident to Secretary of State, who destroyed all the evidence. He destroyed the pictures of the accident. He destroyed the video. Fred Sidway survey swore to me that I would get this video of the accident, which if you saw, you wouldn't want Jacob Sidway driving a tricycle for Roseville. And if I was lying about this, why would I make up this flyer and go to all the businesses around here trying to get witnesses to this accident? So I made up a flyer of this accident, trying to get witnesses because they destroyed all the evidence. And I'd like to know why you've never, I believe you've never reported this to Secretary of State. It's on my record. It should be on my record. Also, Secretary of State wanted to know why Jacob Sidway is listed as a female. He's not a female, is he? I don't think so. Also, you deleted my police report. I stated in my police report twice that he ran the stop sign and was speeding. And when this accident occurred, he admitted it was his fault because there were two witnesses talking about it I could have done. And then when they told me to come to Roseville parking lot, that's when Fred Service handed me a ticket. I said he was out of his mind. Yeah, that's when he swore I could get the video. And then when I got home, I called him by phone, and there's a phone conversation where he swears I'm going to the video of this accident, which I never did. I tried for 2 months to get a court date and to get the video, the pictures, and my own deleted police report, and they kept delaying it. And then 103 days later, I got a letter from Secretary of State where they suspended my driver's license. So I called them and asked them why, and they said to call Roseville. I called Roseville, and that's because I never went to court over this accident. And I asked them, well, when did I ever get a court date? I tried for 2 months to get a court date, and that's when they said it got lost in the mail. I said, well, why didn't this letter from Secretary of State get lost in the mail? And I believe they said they didn't want that letter to get lost in the mail. That's my court date. That was supposed to get lost in the mail. And it's just been harassment ever since. My lawyer, William Stugart, was bought off. He dropped my appeal before Judge Foster. I want to go before Judge Foster and tell him all this.
Mayor, I have three.
I ask you to conclude your remarks, sir.
Well, first of all, can you tell me why? I'd like to find out why you never reported this accident to Secretary of State.
Okay, I have no direct knowledge of that.
Mayor, can I assist on this?
Go ahead, Mr.
Thank you. The gentleman's given a rather lengthy resuscitation of events here, and most of these events involve either actions within the police department responding to a claimed event or actions within the court system. It would be more appropriate for this to be discussed administratively rather than before the council. The council's not prepared this evening to start answering questions on a topic like this. They're not an investigatory agency. They don't have documents before them and so forth. So excuse me, sir.
Let Mr. Dolan speak,
yeah,
sir.
You'll have a chance to respond. I'm not trying to, I just need to not talk at the same time as you so we can both understand each other. I'm not saying that, you know, the city isn't concerned about what your concerns are. It's just that the format of this evening is not a format that's going to produce any meaningful answers for you. You know, we have to sit, if you have some concerns, they can be brought to the administration. The administration can take a look at what your concerns are and try to look into them in a more orderly manner than just firing questions at the council tonight. We're not going to get anywhere tonight just based on the resuscitation that you've given. This is not intended to say that the council isn't concerned on your behalf as a citizen, but this is really not the format tonight to produce any meaningful results.
Well, so the only thing in conclusion that I'm going to tell you is like you, like any other citizen that comes up and makes a claim, I ask the city manager to look into the matter and forward the council a report.
I'll be back next meeting.
Thank you. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard this evening? Anybody else wish to be heard? Yes, sir.
Yeah, Dave Chesney, 30440 Normal. I just want to address the council that the other day I watched the video of the March 4th special council meeting. I wasn't here, but you know, it's nice that you can go on the website and view any former meeting. And I must say I was quite impressed with Mr. Atkins' presentation about 10 or 11 different committees and boards that are actually made up of all volunteers that are not paid, that are putting their time and effort in for the city of Roseville, and I'm glad to see that. I'm glad to see that our city is heading in the right direction. It's good to see that. I just want to tell you guys, I'd like to apply to become maybe get on a board or a committee. I'd love to serve, help serve this city, because I do care about the city of Roseville, considering I've had the chance over 30 years of my life to watch the far east side of Detroit go right down the drain, and we don't need that out here. So, and you talk about like the contract for the, and I think you mentioned it, Mr. Taylor, about, you know, that the union should have a right to negotiate into, you know, doing the city workers doing some of the work. One thing I'm concerned about is, you know, contractors are out to make money and give you guys the savings. But how much money are they making, and at what expense to their employees? You know, that's a big question, you know, you have to answer yourself. And I'll tell you another thing, the recycling cart, I just got one a couple weeks ago, the red one, the red recycling cart on wheels. And you'd be surprised when you just recycle everything that you can, how much that thing will fill up within a week. I'd say you could probably fill three of those little square hand bins with just the one cart, you know. So my daughter tells me, she says, "Dad, don't become a recycling freak." So I told her, "No, just pitch in." You know, my wife, my daughter, my son, you know, I just asked him to do that, and it works. So hopefully more people will get the red recycling carts. It does. It's reduced my trash from 4 bags a week down to about a bag and a half, 2 if I'm lucky. So it definitely works, and we need to see more. I'd like to see more people utilizing it. And another thing, out of all the 11 committees and boards that you mentioned on the March 4th meeting, don't forget about us in the Neighborhood Watch. There's 157 of us active in the Roseville Neighborhood Watch Group. We got a gentleman on the southwest side of the city over there, 10 Mile and Hayes. You know, him and his neighbors have really band together, and they actually shut down a dope house that was trying to start up on their street. I won't mention the street, but it's over there off of 10 and Hayes. And you know what? They're doing, these people are really putting in a good effort. So, yeah, don't forget about Neighborhood Watch. Thank you.
Mayor,
okay, thank you. Mr. Chesney, for you or for the audience at home, if anybody's interested in getting involved in the city, they can give a letter of intent to the secretary in the city manager's office, and a vacancy comes up, we review all the applicants. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard? Anybody else from the public wish to be heard? Seeing none, we'll move into items for discussion by city council. Councilwoman Hall.
Yes, thank you, Mary. Mayor, I'd like to thank the Cub Scouts for leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance tonight. It's so nice to see such fine young men come out and sit through a meeting and just be so attentive. It's really nice to see that we still have those groups and the Cub Scouts and the Boy Scouts still out there doing that in such a long time. 89 years, I think you said? Wonderful. Also, I'd just like to make mention that I did give snow up for Lent, so I hope somebody's listening. That's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Troop 1412. I went to Heron Park. 1412 was alive when I was in elementary school. My brothers will remember, and you're still going. Keep it up. I want to congratulate you. I want to congratulate the Project Art winners, and that's going to be it for me. Take care of each other, please. It's warming up.
Thank you. Councilman Schumer.
Thank you, Mayor. We're all congratulating Cub Scout 1412. Boy Scout?
Boy Scouts.
It says Cub Scout here.
Yeah.
It says it's a technical
honor. Yeah, it did say Cub Scout.
But most importantly, they've been here for a while. We want to help keep them alive. You're having a spaghetti dinner this Saturday, Holy Innocents from 3 to 6. So if the public come out and help them so they can maintain their presence here in Roseville. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilwoman Hagerty.
Thank you, Mayor. I also want to thank the Scout Pack 1412, not only for leading us in the flag at pledged allegiance to the flag, but also for all the services that you do for our community. Thank you so much. We really do appreciate you and all that you do. I also want to congratulate all the PAIR contestant winners and the members of PAIR. They're dedicated and they do such a great job, and we appreciate you as well. I'd like to thank Mr. Connors for his presentation on the community development plan and all the departments that showed up and gave us presentations. It's very nice to know where our money goes when we support these organizations. And I also gave up snow for Lent, but it didn't work. So, and that's all I have, Mayor. Thanks.
Thank you. Councilman McCurdy.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to echo Boy Scout Pack 1412 for all that you do. So keep up the good work, boys. It's nice. And to the PAIR contestants and winners, congratulations to you. And that is all I have, Mayor.
Thank you. Mayor Pro Tem Taylor.
I was never a Cub Scout at 1412, but my son was. And like Councilman Aiello said, guys, thanks. You guys do a great job out there. Community loves when you guys go out there and you help them out. And the city loves it too. So thank you guys very much. And keep Huron Park with smiles over there. That school's doing really good over there. And I know the addition over there really helped out. So thanks for all that. Project Art, like everybody else said, it's a great event for our students in the school. It was nice to see one of our board members from the school board, Mr. DeFelice, come out to see some of the students that received awards. It means a lot to this community. It means a lot to the kids. So I want to thank them for that. Recently, I was able to, I guess you could say on a different matter, I was able to review an email that was put out by a staff member over in East Point. And I just want to make a quick statement that I don't believe the statements are true. I know the person that that wrote that email is, I don't know what his problem is, but we're trying to mend ways between East Point and Roseville. I think it's totally unfair to any one of our staff members. And I can assure you that if any of our staff members were to write a letter like that, deframing or defacing one of our employees, that I'm sure he would be dealt with accordingly. So I'm hoping the City Council in East Point has a little talk with that man. I can tell you that I'm not happy about it. I don't think the people in Roseville are happy about it. And if he's trying to do it for monetary reasons, I think that's totally wrong. And on that, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to say get well wishes to Lieutenant Berlin, who's on the mend right now, the chief's younger brother. And everybody be safe. Thanks.
All right, thank you. To the Boy Scout Pack, you're like a farm club for Eagle Scouts. That's all I can say. You do a fine job. More Eagle Scouts have came out of your pack than probably any other pack in Michigan, I imagine. It seems like every other day we turn around and you have one come out. But not only your pack, but all the Cub Scout packs and the Boy Scout packs within Roseville. They all do a fine job for all our residents, and we commend you for all your hard work. Mr. Chesney, you're right, the Neighborhood Watch, they are a fine organization. They have fine people leading that organization. They do a great job. The city tries to work with them as much as possible. Unfortunately, they're not one of our commissions. They hire and fire their own people. We don't. So, but anyways, I just wanted to let them know that they're greatly appreciated in what they do. I would like to wish Councilman Shoemaker a belated birthday a couple of days ago, I think. So
about a week ago.
He thought he was going to get by the radar this time, but he isn't.
Thanks,
but, I hope I see everybody out at the hockey game on Sunday. It's a good thing. It's a good time. We're going to bring the trophy home this time, I hope, and we'll have a presentation. Maybe I can get the Fraser Mayor to present it back to us like I had to go to, or I should say Mayor Haw had to go there, because I think we haven't had it in a while. So, but anyways, if you're not doing anything on Sunday, please come up to Fraser Hockey Land and see our two fire departments battle it out for the trophy.
Mayor, I think Mr. Ayudo is having a birthday as well.
Oh, I guess you didn't.
So happy birthday, Mr. Ayudo.
Happy birthday to Councilman Ayudo. Awesome. All right. Okay, with that, I have nothing else. Can I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Support. Motion by Councilwoman Hayes, supported by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor. All in favor?
Aye.